Good evening, everyone. Greetings from Coimbatore. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizing team of Sonobus, particular Dr. Mani, for inviting me to be part of this wonderful event. Now, you should be wondering why you need an imaging investigation for hernia, which is obvious. I will try to justify the role of ultrasound in hernia. Now, hernia is protrusion of an organ out of the body cavity in which it normally lies. So, here the body cavity is the abdomen and the hernia protrudes out. That is hernia. So, abdominal wall, it can be abdominal hernia, can be abdominal wall hernia, internal hernia and diaphragmatic hernia. Now, coming to the technique, we have to know the anatomy. It is a dynamic study essential, and then the probe is usually high frequency linear probe, 5 to 12 megahertz. If the patient is obese, then we use the convex probe. We examine at rest, and then when the patient is straining, to elicit the protrusion, and sometimes also an erect posture of the patient. So, abdominal wall hernia, the most common one is the inguinal, which forms 75% of the hernia, which may be indirect in 50% and direct in 25%, or it may be a ventral incisional or umbilical hernia forming 10%, and femoral in a small 3%, and the rest is formed by the unusual type of hernias, which can be the spigelian, the Richter, obturator and the lumbar hernia. Now, coming to the symptoms, the hernia is seen as a visible lump. There may be local pain due to stretching, or there may be pain due to pull of the content like mesentery, or the symptoms may be due to complications. The abdominal wall hernia occurs in weak spots. What are the weak spots? It can be natural weak spot, or it can be acquired. Acquired can be incisional or at the port site following a laparoscopy or following traumatic. The terminology is used in hernia. It may be a reducible hernia where the contents go inside now and then, or it may be irreducible, it's also called incarcerated, obstructed when the content is bowel and it is obstructed, and strangulated if there is no blood supply to the content. And role of ultrasound is in confirmation of the hernia to detect a non-palpable or an unsuspected hernia, and to know the contents, the type of hernia, the defect size for determining the size of the prosthesis, associated conditions and complications, and the post-operative follow-up. So, I will cover this lecture in these headings. Now, technique, as I said, we should examine at rest and at straining. Straining may be one of these, the Valsalva maneuver, head raising, cough or erect posture, and you must look for reducibility and tenderness, and look for the contents and the vascularity. So, the probe used is usually the linear 5 to 10 megahertz probe to study the abdominal wall in detail, or it, when the patient is obese, we may have to use the convex 3 megahertz probe, the conventional probe. So, at rest, you have to see if there is a bulge or if you see the protrusion, and when the hernia is seen at rest, then you must press on the hernia to look whether it is reducible, as shown in this video. So, you see the protrusion of the contents, omentum and bowel, and when you press, the contents go inside the abdomen. So, it is reducible hernia. So, it is present at rest, and then when you press, it gets reduced, and then you measure the defect size like that. Or it may be present at rest. Even then, to confirm that it is hernia, you ask the patient to strain and look for the impulse or further protrusion of the contents to confirm that it is hernia. And the third situation is it is not present at rest. Then you ask the patient to strain like cough, and then the contents protrude out as seen in this video. So, these are the three parts of the technique, and the last one is the head raise. So, here the pictures show the technique of head raise, and here you see at rest, you don't see any hernia. And when the patient raises the head, when strains, then you see the protrusion of contents through the defect. So that is seen in the video. So at present, it is not seen. When the patient raises the head, then you see the protrusion of the contents inside, confirming that it is a hernia. So that is the technique. Then next is the confirmation. So by the technique, you confirm. And in certain situations, you have to differentiate from a mass and a divarication of recti. So thereby confirming. So divarication of recti is the muscles, rectus abdominis muscles are separated, and the linea alba in between gets weakened so that the contents bulge outside. So this has to be differentiated from the hernia of the linea alba, where there is a defect and there is protrusion. So here there is a defect in the linea alba and the contents protrude, whereas here there is weakness of the linea alba, separation of the recti abdomini, and the abdominal contents bulge outside. So that is the difference between divarication of recti. Now it's called diastasis recti. And you measure the distance between the medial borders of the recti and make it in your report. So the abdominal wall masses have to be differentiated. So that is a abdominal wall lipoma, and this is an abscess, and this is inflamed cysticercosis, and that is a rectus abdominis hematoma and a tumor of the abdominal wall. So how to differentiate? By the characteristic appearance, and these masses will not be reducible, and there is no change with straining. So that is how you differentiate from hernia. Sonography is very useful to detect non-palpable or unsuspected hernia. This happens in obese individuals and in interparietal hernia. We'll see that. And in the unusual sites where you don't suspect a hernia, like an obturator hernia. So here, this is a very obese individual. You see the entire depth is occupied by the abdominal wall, and so the bulge will not be seen clinically. So in such situations, ultrasound is really useful. You see the hernia with protrusion of the omentum with outlined by little fluid. Again, here omentum outlined by the fluid. So here ultrasound detects the hernia. And then umbilical hernia. So we come to the umbilical hernia, where there is a protrusion of the contents through the umbilicus or by the side of umbilicus. So here through the umbilicus, the omentum is herniated. So that is umbilical hernia. Here you see the umbilicus here, whereas the hernia has happened by the side. So that is a para-umbilical hernia. So para-umbilical hernia or umbilical hernia can contain bowel loops, as seen here. Now here, this is an umbilical hernia. You see the sac filled with only fluid. So this happens, and that is the defect. This happens when there is ascites in the abdomen due to the cirrhosis. So because there is ascites, only the ascitic fluid goes into the hernial sac, separating the rest of the contents of the abdomen entering into the sac. So that is umbilical hernia containing only ascitic fluid. Now next abdominal wall hernia is port site hernia. Now following laparoscopic port insertion, there may be hernia through the weak spot here. So that is the defect, and you get the port site hernia containing omentum. Now this is in the left mid quadrant, again a port site hernia. Now coming to the inguinal hernia, there are two types, the indirect and direct. Now this is on the left side, this is the pubic symphysis, and you see the inferior epigastric vessels. So the indirect inguinal hernia, you get the hernia the lateral to the inferior epigastric vessels. Indirect, it occurs medial to the inferior epigastric vessels. So the technique is you use the 5 to 12 megahertz transducer, place it transversely over the inguinal region, just above the inguinal ligament. You will get the section, you will see the common femoral artery and vein, and so anteromedial to them will be the internal ring through which the indirect inguinal hernia will happen, or the direct will happen just medial to that, to the inferior epigastric vessels. So that is the technique, the arrest, and then straining, you see the straining, you don't get any protrusion. So that is normal with cough impulse. Whereas when there is hernia, at rest, you see the power loops in there going into the scrotal sac by the side of the testis with some fluid. So that is inguinal hernia. So that is the inguinal hernia present at rest, and you can try to reduce it, and if it is reducible, it escape into the sea. That is the pressure, and it gets reduced. So that is a reducible inguinal hernia. Now here it is not present at rest, but when the patient coughs, you get the omentum bulging into the sac. So this is again the technique of eliciting inguinal hernia. So as I said, this is the on the left side. So this is direct inguinal hernia. You see the cubic symphysis, the inferior epigastric vessels, and the hernial sac is medial. Whereas in the indirect inguinal hernia, that is the inferior epigastric vessels, pubic symphysis, and the hernial sac is lateral to the inferior epigastric vessels. Now in the present day of laparoscopy, this differentiation is not essential. So this is the direct inguinal hernia, medial, and it is due to a defect in the conjoint tendon, weakness of the conjoint tendon, and it is always acquired. And the neck is wider because it is just a weakness of the tendon. Whereas in the indirect inguinal hernia, it is lateral to the inferior epigastric vessels through the internal inguinal ring. So it is through a natural weakness, and the neck is narrow, so chance of complications are more, and it happens in young individuals, and it is through the natural defect. Now hernia versus a mass in the inguinal region, this is an encysted hydrocele of the spermatic cord. It's seen as an oval cystic mass. There will not be any cough impulse. And another differential diagnosis, persistent process vaginalis, where the process vaginalis is not obliterated. As a result, some fluid escapes. So this neck is very narrow, does not allow any hernia, but fluid alone is seen. So in that case, you have to put the patient in erect to rule out hernia. So if you put the patient in erect or during cough, the contents may protrude, making a diagnosis of hernia rather than a persistent process vaginalis. So here at present it is not there. When your patient coughs, the omentum goes into the hernial sac. This is lipoma in the spermatic cord, a very characteristic appearance, and there will not be any change with the cough impulse. This is a ecopua mass in the inguinal region. This turned out to be a desmoid tumor. And another differential diagnosis in the female is cyst of the canal of neck. You see a cyst in the inguinal canal. That is a DD for inguinal hernia in a woman. Now here this is a very rare irregular ecopua mass in a woman with pain during the periods. And this is the mass seen, and on color there is flow seen in it, and it turned out to be endometriosis. Another differential diagnosis is varicocele, a common differential diagnosis where you get dilated veins, cremastic veins in the spermatic cord and in the scrotum, and with color Doppler, you will get reflex of flow in these veins, confirming that it is a varicocele. Differential diagnosis for varicocele will be a lympharynx, where you get on grayscale similar appearance, but on color Doppler, there will not be any flow or there will not be any reflex of venous flow. And rarely you may get the filarial dance confirming that it is a lymphatics. When in all cases of inguinal hernia in males, we must document the size of the testis because postoperatively there may be ischemia of the testis, there is may be reduction. So to avoid that confusion, you must always document the size of the testis when you are reporting inguinal hernia in a male. Now associated condition, very common associated condition in a male with inguinal hernia is undescended testis, where you see the scrotal sac with the hernia containing omentum and bowel, and you see the undescended testis in the inguinal region more proximal to the contents. Now coming to the contents, so you have to report about the contents of the hernia. It may be fat, it may be omentum, it may be a bowel, it may be uterus or ovary, or it may be urinary bladder. Now here you see the fatty hernia of linear elbow. You see the protrusion of the poperitoneal fat into the hernia. Here there is echogenic omentum forming the content. Here there is collapsed bowel loops forming the content. And here there is herniation of the part of the urinary bladder. And here you get the ovary and the fallopian tube as contents in the inguinal hernia. Very rarely the content may be omentum along with an omental metastasis in a case, in a patient who has been operated previously for ovarian carcinoma, or it may be rarely a colon, distended colon. Now here there is bowels as the content and showing the peristalsis confirming that it is bowel, or it may be omentum in the inguinal hernia with the testis. The content here is the ovary in a child. You see the bulge there, and that is the ovary in the forming the left inguinal hernia. Or rarely the uterus also may escape besides the ovary and the fallopian tube, in a rarely when the hernia is large. So here there is a hernia containing bowels. Besides bowels, there is also herniation of the urinary bladder. With cough, you get the bladder. With atresting, it is not there. I can see the same in the real time. You see the herniation of the bladder into the hernia. Now, complications may be irreducibility, obstruction, and strangulation. So, irreducible hernia may be due to narrow neck or addition of the content and the sac. So, it will be seen at rest, and it should be with the pressure, it will not reduce. So, it is irreducible. Because of the irreducibility, the neck will be obstructed, so there will be accumulation of some fluid in the sac. So here there is a incisional hernia with a bowels and omentum. There is fluid and it is irreducible. This is femoral hernia, again containing omentum and fluid, and it is not reducible. So it is present at rest, it is irreducible and fluid. Those are the features. Now obstruction happens when the content is bowel, and when the lead point may be hernia. So when you see hernia, you must suspect obstruction, and you must look for dilated loops in the abdomen. Or in the reverse, if you see the small bowel obstruction in the abdomen and you don't see any other cause, then you must look for hernia as the cause, either way. So here this is sign of small bowel obstruction. You see the dilated loop with to and fro hyperperistalsis, and when you see that, then you trace the loop, and if you don't see any cause, then look for the hernial sites. Now, obstruction in the hernia can be to the afferent loop, efferent loop, or both. So here you see the schematic. This is the hernia. There is obstruction to the afferent loop. As a result, the bowels inside the abdomen are dilated, and in the hernia, the afferent loop is collapsed and it is obstructed at the neck. So this is dilated bowels in the abdomen, collapsed bowels in the sac, and is afferent loop obstruction. Now here you see dilated loops in the abdomen as well as in the sac. So abdomen as well as in the sac, and you see collapsed efferent loop. So that is the efferent loop. That is the efferent loop, collapsed efferent loop. So that is efferent loop obstruction. And then you get obstruction to both, that is the closed loop obstruction. Now here you see dilated small bowels in the abdomen, dilated loops in the hernial sac, and so that is real time showing the peristalsis. So that is efferent loop obstruction. When the obstruction is to both afferent and efferent loops, it is a closed loop obstruction, either due to a narrow neck obstructing both the loops, or it may be due to valvulus of the loop inside the sac. So here you will see dilated small bowels in the abdomen, disproportionate dilatation of the loop in the hernial sac, and then you will see the distended loop in the hernial sac will be tense. It will not be compressible, it will be tense, and there will not be any gas because there is proximal obstruction also, and it will be aperistaltic because it is tensely distended and obstruction at the neck. So this is a case of ventral hernia with closed loop obstruction. Rarely it may be colonic obstruction. You see dilated bowels in the abdomen. You see dilated colon in the abdomen. And in the sac also you see a dilated colon. So this is inguinal hernia containing colon which is obstructed. Now we come to strangulation. So what are the features? It is irreducible. It will be tender. There will be some fluid in the sac. Thick walls of the loop of bowel, and if it is loop of bowel, it will be peristaltic, and there will be ischemia. on color Doppler, there will not be any flow. So dilated small bubbles in the abdomen, and this is a case of umbilical hernia. It is irreducible and tender. There is some fluid in the sac. This is a bowel, so it shows thick walls. It is aperistaltic. When you put color, there is no flow. So this is strangulation of umbilical hernia containing a bowel loop. So in contrast, only when there is irreducibility, you will see flow in the mesentery or in the bowel wall. So that is the difference of strangulation and obstruction. Strangulation can happen even in content is omentum. So it is irreducible and tender. There is fluid in the sac. Content is omentum. And when you put on color, there is no flow in the omentum. So that is strangulation containing omentum. Now coming to unusual hernias. One is the spigelian hernia. The anatomy is you get the lina semilunaris, the lateral border of the rectus, and linea semicircularis, the posteriorly the aponeurosis of the three muscles and divide into the anterior and posterior rectal sheath. Below the linea semicircularis, the aponeurosis, the posterior rectus sheath is not present. So there is a potential weakness there through which the hernia happens. So that is the spigelia hernia. At the junction of semilunaris and the lateral border of the rectus, defect in the aponeurosis of the transversus abdominis, and it is intraparietal between the layers of the muscles of the abdomen. So there is no bulge. It will not be seen as a bulge. So that is the defect, and you see the herniated bowel, and that is the superficial muscle. Because of the muscle, there is no bulge. So that is an intraparietal hernia. So in spigelian hernia, in a male, there may be also cryptorchidism. That's called Ravindran syndrome. As you see here, the spigelian hernia on the right, and it also contains the undescended testis in the sac. You see the bowels and the undescended testis. So this is called Ravindran syndrome. And that is the real time showing the hernia containing bowels and of course the undescended testis in the sac. Now coming to the femoral hernia. Now anatomy, it is more common in women, and you see the inguinal ligament, and below the inguinal ligament you get the common femoral artery, common femoral vein, and medial to that you get the femoral canal through which the hernia happens, the femoral hernia. So here that is the inguinal ligament, the common femoral artery, common femoral vein, and that is the femoral canal, and through which the hernia happens. So it happens from it. The neck is posterior to the inguinal ligament, and then the sac comes anteriorly. Whereas in the inguinal hernia, it happens superficial to anterior to the inguinal ligament, and then goes posteriorly into the scrotum. So that is the difference between femoral and inguinal hernia. Now, technique for femoral hernia is like for inguinal hernia, and you see below the inguinal ligament, and below the inguinal ligament you see the common femoral artery, common femoral vein, and this is the region of the femoral canal. So when the patient coughs, you must look for the bulge here. At rest, you see the common femoral artery, the common femoral vein will be compressed by the hernia, and that is the hernia medial to the common femoral vein, and that is the femoral hernia. You see the real time. You see the common femoral artery and the vein. So that is the femoral artery, vein, and you see the bulge happening medial to the vein, compressing the vein. That is femoral hernia. Then we come to the obturator hernia. So obturator hernia is very rare. It happens in through the obturator foramen in elderly multiparous women because of the weakness of the muscles, particularly when they lose weight. And it happens deep to the pectineus muscle. It is deeper compared to the inguinal hernia. You see, I have used the convex probe because it is very deep. Patient had intestinal obstruction. So this is the pectineus muscle deep to the common femoral artery and the vein made out by the color Doppler. So this is the pectineus muscle, and the bowel lip is seen here deep to the pectineus. This is the obturator hernia. Now, rare type of hernia is Richter hernia, where there is herniation of the anti-mesenteric wall of the bowel. Only part of the circumference of the bowel protrudes through the defect of the abdominal wall, does not produce obstruction because the entire lumen is not herniating. And this the peculiarity of this hernia is, the strangulation and necrosis happens without obstruction, so the diagnosis is missed, and the patient presents with peritonitis. So this is part of the circumference of the bowel protruding, and there is some fluid. So this is paraumbilical hernia. You get some fluid. This is a young girl presenting with severe pain, and you see the bowel loop, and this was showing peristaltic, so confirming that it is bowel, part of the bowel, and the bowel loops in the abdomen were not dilated, abdomen was not distended. So this is a Richter hernia. Now another case of Richter hernia, you see the bowel loop in the abdomen, normal, but part of it is protruding through the paraumbilical hernia, and then you see part, it is necrosed and produces a small abscess in the abdominal wall. And layer type is a hernia after a trauma in the lumbar region. And still more rarer is parastomal hernia by the side of stoma, like a colostomy. By the side you see the hernia. Ultrasound is also useful in the post-operative follow-up to look for any fluid collection so that it can be aspirated, and to look for the prosthesis, adhesion and recurrence, and testicular ischemia. So here, this is immediately after surgery, you get a fluid collection, that is a seroma, which can be aspirated. Little later, you see fluid collection secondary to inflammation, mesh inflammation, you get fluid around the curled mesh, so mesh is already not functioning. And then you can get a recurrent hernia by the side of the mesh or deep to the mesh. And then you may get bowel getting adherent to the mesh, producing small bowel obstruction. And this is curled mesh again, and which can produce inflammation and with a tract to the skin. So the sinus tract may not heal. And the mesh can migrate. Here you see the mesh is migrated from the inguinal region to anterior to the bladder. And very rarely it can migrate into the bladder, producing recurrent urinary tract infection. You see the mesh within the bladder, and that was removed by cystoscopy. To conclude, the role of ultrasound is in confirmation, know the type, the contents, the defect size, reducibility, associated conditions, complications, and you have to document the testis size in inguinal hernia in males. And if you see dilated bowels in the abdomen, the cause is not seen, you must look for hernia as the cause. Thank you.